straight from the Chicago Actors Studio, it's Late Night Chicago with your host, Sarah Kopp. Tonight's co-host, Roberta De Niro. From JBTV, Jerry Bryant. And a special appearance by Edward Dennis Fogell. Now here's your hosts, Sarah Kopp and Roberta De Niro.
And I'm Roberta De Niro. Thank you for joining us tonight. We have a great show for you tonight. We have JBTV, the guy who started JBTV, and Jerry Bryant is his name. Jerry Bryant is with us. Yeah, 35 years in the business.
Can you believe it? And he has only taken one sick day in the entire 35 years, and that's because he was battling cancer. What kind of dedication is that? That is amazing.
And you know what the thing, too, is that this is something that he started out of a passion to help musicians to actually, you know, promote their careers.
Yeah, that's absolutely incredible.
That's so exciting.
And he offered a platform to so many new musicians that, like, Kill Hannah, like Radiohead, like Bjork. He was the first one to start playing Bjork. And now she is heard all over the place, and she is the essence of true art, just like JB is.
Right, it's so exciting. And we really are looking forward to introducing him. But before we do that, let me ask you, how's your little daughter doing?
Oh my gosh, she is great. So, funny thing, she lost a tooth. She lost this tooth the other day. And somebody may have forgotten to play Tooth Fairy.
Oh, no.
I know.
No.
Oh, she walked into my room with just the saddest look on her face. She was so disappointed.
Okay, how did you get out of that one, Sarah?
Well, while she was at school, I put the money in there, and I'm like, hey, the Tooth Fairy was on the wrong time zone. Oh. Hey, she believed me. She believed me.
Well,
so.
Of course she believed you. You're her mother, right? But she's got some talent, too. She's following in mommy's footsteps. I've seen some stuff that you've posted on Facebook. But you know what I wanted to share with you? Remember Jayla, I brought my great niece in here?
Oh, how could I forget?
Oh, she's so cute. Anyway, she is actually just completed a Kohl's modeling deal.
Oh,
and yeah, we just got the little printout today that she's online.
Oh, my God.
Yeah,
oh,
I'm so excited.
Congratulate her for me, will
Thank
you?
Thank you, absolutely.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, so many great things happening here at the Chicago Actors Studio.
Right.
Oh, it's wonderful. And she was getting coaching here, wasn't she?
Yeah, she was. Actually, was taking classes with Denise.
Oh,
who runs all the children's classes here. So, absolutely. Yeah, definitely helped her to be more confident in front of the camera. And, you know, they have a great coach, too, there for the children. Absolutely. You know, he just helps them to be comfortable and tells them to jump and play and all this kind of stuff. So it's cool.
Yeah, Anya actually had an audition for a Disney commercial. She got called back for it.
Oh, fabulous.
Yeah, that was a few months ago, but she absolutely loved the experience. Had such a great time there.
Now, she's how old?
She's 7 and a half.
7 and a half, yeah. So Jayla's 6. So, you know, in this business, you gotta, you know, it's good to start out early, but you don't necessarily have to, because we have a lot of people here that are doing really well. And, but we really want to talk to you today about JB.
Gosh, what do you say? You think it's about time that we start talking to Jerry?
I think Jerry.
Yeah, I think it's some Jerry time.
Let's bring Jerry out.
Let's bring Jerry out. We're going to take a quick break and bring out some Jerry. Excited to bring out Jerry Bryant. He is the producer, interviewer, head honcho, ruler of everything of JBTV. Now, pretty much every artist that you know of has come through JBTV. Have you heard of, say,
Smashing Pumpkins?
Oh, absolutely.
21 Pilots?
Oh, yeah.
Bjork?
Oh, I don't know.
Bjork?
Oh. Okay, I'm dating myself.
Well, Jerry Bryant has interviewed all of them. Please give a warm welcome to Jerry Bryant.
Hey. Hello. Pleasure meeting you two ladies here. Well, it's so exciting to be here, too, so.
Now, tell us, JBTV, how did you get your start?
Well, I got my start in radio back in the 60s. Mm-hmm. This is really dating me now. But I started out, I had a little pirate radio station when I was in high school.
Oh.
So I couldn't wait to get suspended to pay attention to the radio station. But then I got involved with the real radio station, 93 WQFM in Milwaukee. It's a full 50,000-watt radio station that was easy listening.
Okay.
And the owner passed away, and if you're in the right place at the right time, you try to take advantage of things.
Right,
so I said, oh, sure. So I ran the radio station, and I changed it from easy listening, beautiful music, Henry Mancini.
Right, right.
You know, the Living Strings to, you know, Led Zeppelin,
yes.
ELO,
oh,
you know,
wow.
All these great bands.
Yeah.
And that's how I got started really in radio. And then I ran into this guy called Joe Kelly. And mm-hmm. he was a famous voiceover talent who was sort of in drug rehab.
Oh, gosh.
He used to work at 610 KFRC in San Francisco.
Okay.
And so he was involved with the voiceover work, and I was doing commercials, and I go, I need a voiceover talent. Because I'm a producer. I'm an engineer. I love playing with the equipment and editing. And this is back in the days when you had a splice audio tape.
Okay.
Put little marks on it and, you know, work the machines and everything. So
right.
we did tour commercials.
Oh. Hmm.
And because I had a radio station, the old days of promoting tours, like if you had an artist come to town, you'd have a kid go, here's $10, take these flyers and put them on cars. And we said, well, we got a radio station, we're playing all this music, let's start doing promotions going, you know,
okay.
and let's sell out a band in advance, like 2 or 3 weeks.
Right.
And that's how I started doing commercials, and that's how I made money.
I see. Okay.
Gotcha.
And we worked for about 300 radio stations throughout the United States. Z100 New York, The Loop FM 98 here in Chicago,
wow.
KFRC San Francisco, KLOS Los Angeles, just tons of radio stations. They were all number one in the market. And so we started working with concert promoters. And in Milwaukee, there was 1812 Overture, which is a record store. So we would do commercials for that, and then Randy McGalrath, who had Stardate Productions, says, I'm doing tours, and I found this theater in Milwaukee called the Uptown Theater.
Interesting.
And so we started booking concerts, and one of the first concerts was Bruce Springsteen, who no one knew about.
Oh, wow.
And
love. Love Bruce Springsteen.
And it was Harry Chapin we brought in.
Oh, uh-huh. Harry Chapin.
Yeah,
oh.
And so a number of these artists, you know. Remember the guy that did Jessie's Girl?
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, my gosh.
And that's
great
when
song.
I first saw tons of ladies' underwear on the stage.
Oh, gosh.
He was in the Young and Restless or one of those shows,
yes.
right?
Oh, wow.
Yeah, he was like an actor, too, so,
right.
you know. But he had that song, Jessie's Girl.
Yeah, it was a great
you know?
Song.
So that's how I got into doing promotions. So we did all the major tours from Pink Floyd, ELO, Heart, Jefferson Starship, Jefferson Airplane. You name it, we've done a commercial for it.
I see.
And that sort of got me into doing, we made money doing that.
Right.
But then we started doing television commercials.
Hmm.
And on this big 1-inch reel of videotape, you know, back in the day, it used to be 1-inch and 2-inch videotape.
Mm-hmm.
And on this 1-inch tape, there'd be all the artists like Madonna. So we'd use, you know, Hello, mm-hmm. Vogue, that would be in the commercial.
Uh-huh.
But then there'd be this artist like Peter Murphy. And he would be there, and it would be like, no one's playing my music, but you're the only one in America that's playing my, and it was Scarlet Thing and You, and his wife made this beautiful video, I mean, they spent a lot of money on it,
right.
He was so depressed that MTV didn't care about it,
aww.
And so the fact that Peter Murphy, this legend,
yes.
you know, is at my studio doing an interview, and we're just sitting on the floor in the corner of the studio. And he said how depressing it is with, you know, that they don't accept your music right away. I
right.
had the same problem with Jeff Buckley,
okay.
the late great. He, at the time, nobody cared about him.
Wow.
You know, the record company goes, play rock and roll.
Yeah.
You should be rocking. There's no reason why you're like, you know, give us some rock and roll. And he goes,
right.
well, I'm doing these cool songs. I'm, you
yeah.
know, it's my music.
Yeah.
And so he did Kick Out the Jams. We shot his last concert, which became a DVD that I put together for
fabulous.
The family. And he did Hallelujah, the original version.
Oh,
oh.
One of my all-time favorite songs.
I get just talking about it,
yeah.
I'm getting goose
goosebumps.
Pimples.
Yeah.
Yeah, I call it skin orgasm.
Oh.
that okay here on the
Yeah, I think that's fine.
It was one of those special moments that the Metro, which is a very noisy club, it was so quiet. So quiet, and he's like on his guitar, and you never heard that, you know. It's just, it was one of those songs that is so inspirational and so great. And
wow.
And so then we did Siamese Dream back in the day with, you know, the Smashing Pumpkins, their record release party at the Metro.
Right, right.
Yeah.
So you started out, you were how old? 14?
I was probably, 14, 15. I mean, I was doing radio when I was 5 or 6. I think it's like any good profession. If you really want to do it and you have a passion for it.
Right, right.
You know.
So, but you liaison from actually producing radio to...
Doing television.
To doing television.
Yeah, I love television. When I was a little kid, I would sit there and I made a fake TV camera and I'd watch The Untouchables. Like, I was like...
Right. So, do you still have that, you know, the television commercial thing, or...?
Well, that business, we worked for literally, I'll tell you, this is the problem with the whole world.
Okay.
Everything starts out really great. Like, the movie business starts out, everybody's doing it for the art.
Right.
Then all of a sudden, all these individual studios are making all this stuff, and then all of a sudden, they're all consolidated.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Well, when we were in radio, I had 300 clients I was doing work for.
I was going to say, I mean, that's pretty hefty.
And 300 clients.
Client load.
It was all different, so you work, it was a cool thing, you know?
Right, yeah.
But when you are doing, you know, when all of a sudden it got consolidated, everybody we were working for, you know, the management sort of said on-air talent was talking pieces of meat.
Okay.
Well, the morning show, you're paying them a lot of money, but they're the ones that are making you rich.
Right.
Yeah.
This is what they, people are waking up to your radio station and they're listening to whoever's on the radio. That's your personality.
Right, yeah. Right.
And they didn't think of that because it all got down to money, you know, like, oh, they're not worth that, you know,
that kind of thing. Okay.
But anyhow, when consolidation happened, all the stations decided not to advertise. I mean, when have you seen a radio station ad on television? Very seldom.
Yeah, you don't. Yeah. You don't hear it. So anyway, you have a new studio?
Yes, I have. Well, I've been doing JBTV for 35 years.
35 years, yes.
I moved to Chicago when Mayor Jane Byrne was here.
Oh, wow.
And they didn't have cable in Chicago.
That's right. Huh.
And so I could see MTV. We had a satellite dish. Mm-hmm. And that's back when satellite, you could watch NBC. And when the breaks go on the NBC Nightly News. And then you'd still see the camera, and he's doing the makeup. People are coming in because it was the beginning of television. It was so exciting.
Right, you know? Right. Yeah.
And it's the beginning of every industry that way.
Yes.
You start with the passion, and then all of a sudden money gets involved.
Exactly.
And it sort of taints a lot of things.
Right.
That's one thing that I find to be so interesting about your show. You do it for the passion of it.
Truly.
You have continued to just harness the artistry and to help promote the artists in the essence of who they are, rather than telling them what to do.
Right. I don't want to tell anybody what to do. This is their art.
Yeah.
You know, and if they can come on JBTV and perform to a small audience, where the audience is like right there, right, looking at you.
Right.
And if they can perform there, they can perform anywhere.
Exactly.
Mm, yeah. You know?
Right. Because if you're in front of 10 people or 10,000 people or whatever, it doesn't really matter.
It's all about the art of it.
It's all about the passion.
They're doing their songs for themselves.
Right.
Whether one person or a million people are going to hear it.
Right. Of course they want a million to hear it.
Oh, absolutely.
Right?
Well,
absolutely.
Then they have stage fright, too. A lot of artists do have stage fright.
I know.
I guess it's...
It's kind of...
Yeah, especially at the beginning. You know,
I like to say you're excited versus like fright. You know, because that excitement.
Well, just to
helps
get up and perform.
Exactly.
I mean, it's an art form in itself.
Absolutely.
A lot of artists just sit there with their eyes closed and are sort of boring.
Yeah.
You know, the ones that put on a show are the ones that become super famous.
Super
you
successful.
Know?
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Exactly.
Unless the songs are so great, and then they can they can be whatever they want.
Right. Right. Well, yeah, I didn't realize how much of an art it is, you know, just acting until I came here to the Chicago Actors Studio. I mean, it definitely, there is an art to acting.
Well, I think I respect actors.
I respect them. Absolutely.
And I'll tell you, when a good film happens, it goes beyond the actor. It's like, you don't care who it is. All of a sudden, they're playing the part.
Exactly.
And it means so much.
And it draws you in.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's
real.
How you know.
It has to be real.
Absolutely.
Exactly. Yeah. So that's good acting. I couldn't do that.
Yes. But we were talking about your studio and the new studio. And where is that located again?
At 318 West Grand Avenue.
318 West Grand.
Yeah.
And there is room for how many people to come and view the JBTV show?
We get about 100 or so that can come into the studio.
So that's fabulous.
Yeah.
And it's free.
It's totally free.
Totally free. So let's make sure we...
you know, go and see it. I'm definitely, I don't know about you, Sarah, but I'm going to go check it out.
Oh, my God.
You're welcome. Okay, cool. That would be great.
All of your audience is welcome to come, too.
Yes.
Oh, do you hear that? We'd love to have you. Yeah.
Well, and the other thing.
We need some serious actors to sit there and go, yeah.
I know, right? We'll be in the audience. Yeah. Exactly.
You know, they have the stunt audience in the front. And if you don't perform, you know, you're out. You got to be there like, oh, I'm excited to be here and seeing this band, you know.
Now,
which is fake. I don't like that either.
Right, exactly.
I mean, it's got to be real.
Absolutely. You know? And you know, you were mentioning, too, that you have a lot of memorabilia.
Oh, I got tons of it. It's all the real deal. It's not like going to Planet Hollywood where it's all fake.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, when somebody comes to watch the show, is it there's like a hallway they walk through with all the memorabilia?
Yeah, it's all there. It's in a front lobby. It's a small, intimate studio.
Okay, fabulous.
Yeah, it's a cool place, much like a studio here. It's a cool place.
Isn't it? Yeah. It really is. It's like a little gem. Nestled in Lincoln Park. So anyway, tell us about you mentioned that you met Bruce Springsteen.
Well, I didn't actually meet him.
Oh, you
I did the commercials
you
for
did the
it.
Commercials.
And I'll tell you, this is the problem with what I do. I'm a production guy.
Okay.
So my voice talent, Joe Kelly, will go, oh, we got all these stations that got to get this production out.
Yeah.
So like a good example, we did Pink Floyd.
Yeah.
Okay, Milwaukee County Stadium. Mm-hmm. So it was all set up. It was, and the last minute, oh, Jerry, you got to get these promos out for KLOS. They got this new contest starting tomorrow, and they're being FedEx. So I had to work.
Okay.
Yeah, and when we did Bruce and Springsteen and Harry Chapin and those concerts at the Uptown Theater, I was on the radio.
I see.
Oh, gotcha. So I'm at the station going, go to the concert tonight. This new artist, Bruce Springsteen.
Right. Oh, I love it.
Nobody knew how to pronounce his name.
Okay.
It was either way. Now everybody knows the correct way. But, you know.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I just remember my girlfriend from Jersey, she actually ran into him in the grocery store.
Wow.
And I was like, okay, that's wow.
Well,
because I always loved his music.
It's just talent.
Yeah, pure talent. Yeah.
It means so much, you know.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, and what you do means so much. So much to the artists, and I think also to just share new talent with people, because, you know, there's so much competition out there in the music industry. And
it's difficult, and it's hard to be. You know, now with the internet, we've got so much capability to see so many great things.
Right.
But where is the central place to find these things?
Exactly.
Like in the old days, there used to be TV shows like the Ed Sullivan Show.
Yes. Mm.
Well, it wasn't all music. They had jugglers and they had other acts, and it was sort of a variety thing, you know?
Yeah.
And that made artists. Look at the Beatles.
I know.
That was one of their planned promotions.
Absolutely.
And that launched them, you know?
Yes, absolutely.
And the controversy around long hair and this and that.
Right.
Then the same thing with artists, too, when they say you've been a sellout because your music's in a commercial. Well, that's nowadays how you make money as an artist, selling your music.
Right.
And we've had a lot of artists on the show where that's all, you know, that's how they're making their money.
Right, exactly. Very cool.
You've met all these different artists and you've talked to them on JBTV. Now, what is kind of your interview style, would you say?
Just like it is here, I just sort of ad-lib.
Yeah?
I like listening to what they say and following up, because to me, it's so hard. There's a lot of hosts, you know, like if you look at the late night shows, I think Jimmy Fallon's a great sketch guy. He's a bad interviewer.
Right.
Because he's got the card there with the questions.
Yes.
Yet you take Jimmy Kimmel or Stephen Colbert or Conan O'Brien.
Right.
They are radio people
who
are now ad-libbing with what's going on.
Yeah.
So if something crazy happens, they can react to it immediately, which keeps things spontaneous.
Right,
and I think that's awesome.
Yeah, and it keeps it interesting and that kind of thing.
Yeah.
So if you had, like, do you have a story you want to share with our viewers about?
I got a million stories.
I know you do. I know you do after 35 years.
I got a lot of dirty stories, too.
Oh, okay.
Oh. This is late night Chicago.
This is late night, right? I don't know. Are there any rules?
Oh, late night is late night.
I know. But if there's a story that really resonates in your brain about
there are so
something.
Many. You know, we had a funny thing. The Bare Naked Ladies from Canada.
Yeah.
Right.
We did their first show in the United States.
Okay.
Because nobody cared about them, you know.
Right, right. Mm-hmm.
And they were doing stuff with Much Music up there, which they had this corner booth where you go in, like, and you perform.
Yeah.
That's how they got discovered. But they couldn't break out in America. So we did a concert.
Okay.
And during the interview, they had a LaCroix, and I use shotgun mics. So picture a bottle here of LaCroix water with a shotgun mic, and now he's sort of on his back doing one of these weird kind of exercise things as a joke.
Yeah.
And he goes for the mic to his butt, and the water goes pouring right on him.
Oh, no.
Very, very funny.
Right, right.
You have to see it.
You have to believe it, right?
Yeah, but it looked like he's got this wet spot, you know.
Oh, no.
So that was one, you know. But we've had artists do all kinds of crazy things, you
right.
know. Yeah. I mean, a good example, Green Day came in, and they were tired of MTV, you know,
okay.
and they go, what do you want to do on JBTV? We want to smoke a joint. I go, okay.
Oh, no. Yeah, well, now that's less frowned upon, right? I mean, everybody's medicinal marijuana and that
kind
of stuff.
I tell you, that got me through my stage 4 cancer.
Did it?
That's been the savior for me because okay. I had a lot of nausea and stuff. Boy, we're sure we're going from entertainment to now cancer.
I know, right? Whoa! Like, take that ride. But you know what? It's you're a great example for somebody that has gone through what you've gone through. Some people, if their doctor tells them stage 4 cancer, they're checking out mentally.
But it's not that way anymore.
It's
modern
not.
Medicine
it
is a
really
whole different
isn't.
Thing.
Right.
And even with the chemotherapy, I thought, oh, I'm going to lose my hair and this stuff. Well,
yeah.
it's very. They got like 300 different types of chemo now.
Exactly.
Wow. And at the beginning, they just had one that did all this terrible stuff
right,
to you. So
right.
things are so much better. And I've met so many cancer survivors now.
Right. So
who are out there
you stay hopeful.
Are, yeah,
yeah.
And you got to fight and you can't get depressed because
yeah,
it's so
right.
easy when you're on
oh,
chemotherapy
yeah.
or you get these things. You just lay around going, I'm so depressed.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
I can't do anything. And you get tired and you lose energy, but you got to stay positive.
Right.
Yeah.
So your show, because you kept working through all that.
Music. Well, I even had my surgeon. You know, I've yet to win a lottery. But I won a lifetime lottery. I ran into my surgeon right by the water reclamation district downtown.
Okay, wow.
And he's on a bicycle path with his two kids, teaching them. And he says, JBTV. So I thought it was a viewer. I didn't even know who he was.
Right, right.
And he goes, I got to talk to you. You know, I've been looking at your CT scans. You have a baseball-sized tumor. You got to get
oh
this.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. Okay. And I go, I'm going to do it in October. And this is the beginning of summer.
Okay.
I'm going, Lollapalooza's coming
right.
up.
Right, yeah, you got too much going on.
I got all these
on.
Concerts
right,
yeah. and stuff. And he says, you don't have.
You don't have till
wow.
October.
No.
Okay.
And so I immediately booked it, and then they got to do this cleanse,
yes.
and it didn't work right. And he says, don't go to the emergency room. But I was within hours of dying.
Oh, wow.
Because it was impacted, and it was a baseball size, and it was ready to explode. And
my gosh.
It's like when you have an appendicitis.
Yes. Yeah.
You will die.
Yes, absolutely.
And he says, you know, so I keep telling him, you saved my life. And he goes, no, it's the team.
Right, right.
Because they're it's a whole team of doctors at Northwestern.
Right.
I
shout out to Northwestern, right?
I have
mean, seriously.
Outlook on life is totally different now.
That's fabulous.
Yeah. Yeah.
And how has it changed?
Everything. You look at everything differently. You look at the colors of things differently. It's a whole different thing.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah.
Just more appreciative. And
oh,
more,
absolutely.
Like an attitude of gratitude type
yeah.
of thing through
yeah.
the day.
Yeah.
Well, that's fabulous.
Yeah.
I think what you do is so wonderful. I mean, like I said, for the artists, it's just giving them a voice. You know,
I want to give people encouragement.
Right.
It means so much at the beginning of your career to have somebody say, you got a little bit of talent
That's
there.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think you could go someplace, right?
You know, because so many times people say, oh, you're never going to amount to anything.
Yeah.
Get a real job. I heard that all my life.
Oh,
you know,
I know,
get out of
too.
Radio. Get out of this business.
Oh, my gosh,
you know?
Yeah.
I'm sure starving actors all over the place are in the same thing, you know?
Right.
Yes,
constantly.
You know, get a real job. You're smart. You could be an attorney or whatever.
Right.
You got to do your passion.
That's right.
Yeah. Life
Absolutely.
Is too short.
It is way too short.
Too short to let your passion
Yeah, because you know what?
You know,
just yesterday
thing.
I was 21. It just goes so fast.
Yeah, it sure does.
Now, one thing that I find amazing is also the benefit that you had. That
We had a strange 90s
yeah,
benefit.
90s
yeah,
benefit.
Strange 80s. Was it 90s, 90s right?
90s,
strange
90s,
90s yeah.
yeah.
And I had a bunch of bands show up. We got Kill Hannah.
Oh, my gosh.
Ooh.
I love Kill Hannah.
I know. Well, I was the first, you know, to play their stuff way back when.
Seriously?
Yeah.
Oh, my gosh. I remember.
I met
like
Matt Devine at one of the Lollapaloozas way at the early days.
Yeah. Oh, my gosh. I love Kill Hannah.
When he was still at Columbia College.
Oh, wow.
He was a Columbia person?
I believe so, yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah,
that's
yeah.
pretty cool.
Yeah.
Oh, man. But what I love about that is the community that you've helped build came and to help support you in your time of need.
It was
such a testament to who you are.
It was the first
yeah.
time I'm at the Metro and I'm not running TV camera.
Yeah.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
And I'm going, boy, I wish I could do the lights. I wish I could change this. I want to be down the running camera. But
right.
Joe Shanahan gave me his table at the Metro.
Oh, wow.
And Joe Shanahan, what? And he's a cancer survivor, too.
Really?
You know, he had cancer and went through all the same things.
Right,
so.
Right.
There are more cancer survivors now than ever before, you know.
Yeah, actually, the director of the Chicago Actors Studio, his wife went through cancer, and, you know, unfortunately, she didn't survive, but she fought for many years. The doctors told her, you know, she only had so much time, and then, you know, through prayer, and I think they went to Medjugorje, and basically, you know, for a while, she was in remission, and then, you know.
You just never know. You've got to always keep, even then when you're in remission, you don't know.
Exactly.
Yeah.
My stepmother passed of cancer.
Yeah, it seems to be cancer is one degree of separation now with everybody.
Yeah, right.
Everyone.
And that's why, you know, I made it public when I got cancer. I'm saying I'm not going to keep it. Cause so many people want to keep it a secret.
I know.
You want to be strong. You don't want to be weak.
No.
You know.
Exactly.
And so I'm going, no, I'm going to let everybody know.
Let everybody know. Prayers, everybody, you know, right?
And, because it's the only way. And it's sort of, you're not dealing with that trying to act.
Exactly.
You're not feeling good.
Absolutely.
Still, even through all of that, you only missed one episode of your show.
I know, it's crazy. I'm very upset about that. I wanted to... Missing one episode was one too many.
Oh, my goodness.
Did somebody fill in for you?
Yeah, great corner.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Fabulous.
Yeah.
See, so that's good. You have friends that can back you up if you need them.
Oh, yeah, I got great friends. I'm surrounded by just the best people. And everybody at JBTV is a volunteer.
Okay.
All interns. We've had hundreds of interns. The biggest problem I have with interns...
Yes.
And I'm going to say it right to this camera.
Okay.
Here, I'm sure there's an intern.
Yes.
You start out so rough, and then all of a sudden you become gold, and then you leave.
Yes, oh, I know.
It's just when they get great. Finally, I got my crew. Well, now it's another new group.
You're like, no.
But everybody at JBTV is going on the bigger and better things. They've all gone on the great jobs. They're working in broadcasting or related, you know, in the music field or whatever.
Right.
I'm very proud of all my interns.
Right. Yeah. Well, I mean, yeah, they're like your children, right?
They are, yeah.
And when they succeed because of how they started with you, it's kind of a kudos to you.
Yeah.
So it's cool.
Yeah, essentially,
very cool.
You have helped build the careers of so many artists, not just musicians, but so many people that work around a camera.
But they had to have the talent, you know. You have to have the eye to know it's the right, you know, how to frame things.
Yes.
You know, like good movies, they're shot so beautifully.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
Where the cameras now, you don't notice the camera moves. Everything's
right.
Perfect,
exactly.
You know?
It's just like you're seeing it through the director's eyes.
Yeah.
So, oh gosh. So anyway, what were you going to, you were going to ask him some real special question.
Uh-oh. Is this like a late night Chicago question?
Now, I hear that you still have a fundraiser going. Is
yes, we're still doing that.
Yes?
Yeah, because my medical bills are off the charts. Anybody that has gone through cancer knows that it's crazy, you know. And I didn't have any insurance or anything, so it was, you know,
difficult. How can people donate to that?
I have a health awareness. I have a jbtvhealthawareness.org website that I put together.
Okay.
And I'm working with cancer survivors.
Okay.
And
fabulous.
People, I'm talking to doctors, and every interview I do, I'm talking to the artist about health, how to stay healthy on the road, and stuff like that. Because it means so much.
Nutrition is my background.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Well, that means a lot.
Yes. Actually, I just I started a podcast with WGN Studios, and we were talking about colon cancer awareness.
Mm-hmm.
And just, you know, I've been a dietitian for over 30 years, and one of the reasons I came to the Chicago Actors Studio was to get more proficient in front of the camera, and then we decided to do the Late Night Chicago thing.
You're doing a great job.
I know. Thank you. Thank you. But I will tell you that for the information that I, you know, gather from clients and sitting one-on-one with people, most people do not drink enough water, and most people do not get the fruits and vegetables they need. And, you know, those are kind of God's natural compounds that help your body fight, you know, cancer and fight disease in the body in general.
But I started drinking regular Coke again now because I couldn't drink during chemotherapy.
Yes.
You can't drink anything cold.
Yes.
But now I'm enjoying it.
Can I suggest green tea instead? I would like to.
Well,
it's so much better. I don't know if we want to give a shout out to Coke, right?
On that note, it's about time for us to take a break.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
It's been a pleasure. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Late Night Chicago is a production of the Chicago Actors Studio, where dreams are made possible. Call 773 645-0222 for more information about acting classes, private lessons, career counseling, and more.
Welcome to Late Night Chicago, and we're here talking with Jerry Bryant from JBTV. We're talking about him getting through stage 4 cancer and his positive attitude during that, and just the wonderful things he's done for musical talent out here in Chicago and just all over the U.S.,
globally.
Right?
Yeah. Globally. Yeah. Oh, yeah. See? We have artists coming in from all around the world, you know.
Fabulous.
We had BTS in. Which was, this is a Korean group.
Yeah, K-pop, right?
Yeah, and nobody knew about them. And JBTV's got the smallest stage ever. And literally, they put a show on that was just amazing.
Oh, my gosh. So they're from Chicago?
No, they're from Korea.
Korea.
Yeah.
And how did they find out about JBTV?
Well, they called. It sort of just happened. And we were the first television show to put them on. Now they're hosting. They're in commercials, and they're hosting shows and doing stuff.
That's fabulous.
Yeah, it just shows how a genre of music that's infiltrating America right now.
Right.
Yeah. And the fans are going crazy. They're at the United Center. They're selling
out
shows.
Right?
Yeah.
That's incredible.
That's crazy. You know?
So do a lot of directors and music companies look at JBTV? I mean, do you hear from them?
Occasionally. I think a lot of the late night shows probably pick talent from what they see on JBTV.
Oh.
Really? Okay.
The
so
early
after
days,
35
that was a
years.
Lot. Like when David Letterman was on, we'd say, like, we'd have a band on, and then like 2 weeks later, they'd be on the Letterman show.
Right,
you know?
Right. Okay.
Suspicious.
Yeah. Well, it was giving them a chance to see, you know, talent because they could tell, oh, this is a good band. They can perform. They're good on camera.
Right.
They look good. Their songs are good.
Exactly.
It means something.
How about Saturday Night Live?
That's
a
great show.
Because they have some new talent on there, too. Mm-hmm. You know, some good, some...
Well, I think it shows the talent of actors out there, what they do,
absolutely.
And how they put on their skits and how they do things, you know.
Yes.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. But I don't like it when they read the cue cards. To me, they got to look like they're really... communicating, you know.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
And sometimes the hosts are over there,
Yeah, you can kind of tell, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, we actually were at the museum where they show you how they put the...
Oh, the Broadcast Museum.
The Broadcast Museum
in Chicago.
And
they have the Saturday Night Live exhibit there.
They had the exhibit, and, you know, in a week they're putting that show together, so... Yeah, sometimes I think you need a little cue card to...
I don't know. It's grueling.
It's
I could see doing a live show and then having to rehearse all that stuff, you know. Remember when John Belushi was on?
Yes, I do.
And the sketch would go crazy, and he'd just go off.
Right, yeah.
You know? And that was what made that show so
real.
Great. Because it was the mistakes and how they recovered from it.
Exactly.
And how they were on camera, and they weren't... It was about the performance.
Right.
If the audience isn't into it, we're going to start... Doing things.
Doing
and I
things
think that's what made the
show the audience into
cutting
it.
Edge. It
right,
seems like
right.
a lot of sketches now are so planned and they try to be funny
when it's not.
I think anything like good movies, it's got to be real.
Right.
It's got to show the reality of it. And
I
if it's fake or anything doesn't look phony, it really comes off that way.
Absolutely.
You know?
Yeah.
That, I guess, are good actors. I couldn't do that.
Right, right. Well, I mean, that's one of the things we do here at the Chicago Actors Studio is we get students in that really want to learn the craft of acting, and then they, you know.
So they're like interns, right?
We have interns here, too. But
they're starting out.
Starting out, and let me tell you something. A lot of people don't realize how challenging it is to make it real when it comes to acting.
Yes.
Yeah.
So that's one of the things you learn here, and it's a great
Well, even with stage, you know, you've got these stage shows, and then there's people in the audience on their phone or making noise or whatever. It's the good actors don't...
They don't even hear that or
see it. They don't hear that.
Yeah. They're in a zone.
Yeah, they
get
do
into
their
the
thing and nothing's going to interrupt
them.
The show. You
right,
know?
Exactly. Yeah.
That shows the talent. To me, good when I look at a film.
Right.
And if an actor, I go from who that person is to who they're playing.
Right.
Yeah.
And if I get into it, and now I don't care about who the actor, the camera shots or whatever, it's the story.
Right.
And
then you know
so
it's good acting.
Yeah.
Right.
Absolutely.
Well, a team, I guess, it's not just the actors, it's everybody. It's the cameras, the lighting, the script, it's the whole thing.
It's the whole ball of wax, yeah.
And that's what you do here at Actor Studio?
You know, all different aspects of, you know, acting and being in front of the camera. And just helping people to really understand the craft of acting.
I would think acting is therapeutic, too.
Oh, absolutely. Because you kind of you step out of yourself and just
kind of. So matter what you're going through, you know, I see so many musicians that are out there that they're sick before a show, but as soon as the show starts,
they're fine.
There's some adrenaline or something,
yeah.
And they put on a show. The moment they're off, they're, oh.
Yes. Oh, my gosh,
there's something to be said about adrenaline, because it just fires you up, and then afterwards you're like, oh, wow, okay, that's over, right?
But that shows a true talent and someone that's doing something for their passion. No matter what you're doing, it's all about passion.
Right,
And that's what I did with my cancer. I'm taking it to the next level, you know, and fighting it.
Right.
Because I have a passion. I'm not giving up. I'm going to keep working. I'm going to keep fighting.
That's how it works,
It's easy to give up. Anybody can go, like, if you get turned down in an audition, it's like, oh, I'll never get hired. I'll just go back to Wendy's and sell something or whatever they're doing. But no, go out there and do it again and keep working at it. And don't let anybody tell you you can't do it. I think most everybody says, their parents or whoever, get a real job. You know, you're a musician, get a real job. You're going to be an actor. Well, you know, you're working at Starbucks now. Keep doing that.
You know,
but no, you got to follow your passion. Don't let anybody ever, ever, ever tell you not to do what you want to do. Life's too short.
Exactly. JBTV is 100% a passion project of yours,
passion.
Right? Yeah.
I've gone bankrupt with JBTV.
Oh, really?
Yes. And having the latest thing that's happened to me with the medical expenses and everything. Of course, I made it public, and I can see why a lot of people out there want to keep their illness quiet.
Right.
Yeah. They don't want people knowing you're sick.
Okay.
But to me, I'm going, no, I'm going to let everybody know I have cancer.
Right.
You know, because I'm not what I'm going to do.
And that you're fighting it.
Yeah, I'm fighting it.
Right.
And if there's other people out there that are going through the same thing, that may give them a little bit of encouragement.
Yes.
To not give
absolutely.
Up.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And when the doctors say, they told me, you know, cut like 3 to 6 weeks, you know, you could live.
Yeah.
If you don't get this done.
Right.
It's sort of like, oh, okay. But now it's a year later.
Right.
Yeah.
And I'm still here,
God
and I'm
bless.
Feeling better than I did.
That's fabulous.
I'm glad I went through the operation.
Well, yeah, when you don't realize that there's something in you growing, like a cyst or a tumor or whatever.
You just don't know.
Yeah, and it's draining your energy because it's robbing you of your
And then you self-medicate.
Nutrients.
You go online going,
yes.
Here are the symptoms. So I went on a broccoli diet.
Oh,
and then I went
gosh.
On a carrot diet. And then I went on a this diet.
Right.
I mean, I was trying everything to self-diagnose, and none of that had anything to do with it.
Right.
In fact, eating broccoli for when I did was making it worse.
Oh no.
Yeah, because I was eating raw broccoli. And it says, oh, eat broccoli. You know,
yes.
And then other people get 3 avocados a day. And
you have
these energy. Everybody's got a little thing that.
Right, exactly.
But you got to, that's why I went to Northwestern. You know, I mean, team of doctors. It's just, it's so professional.
Right.
They all work together. It's not like, you know, I went to a doctor's office in 2014. They could have told me I should have gotten a colonoscopy or any of this kind of stuff.
Right.
They were more concerned. What's your insurance? And I had great insurance. And what about this? What about that? And they cared more about that than they did about anything else, you know?
Right. And a lot of times, too, when you go to the doctor, they can, you know, there's colonoscopies, but then there's also the test where you could just test your stool. If there's blood in your stool, then they usually go further and test further. So,
they say now at 40, 45, you should get a colonoscopy. So I recommend everybody out there do that. Don't delay. Don't delay.
Yeah.
And they can catch this stuff early on. And with the modern medicine that's out there. And if you go to a decent hospital, I like learning hospitals, nonprofit hospitals.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
You know, there was a news story where they're closing down a hospital because some profit-making group it's not making enough money, you know.
Okay.
And to me, everybody at Northwestern, because it's an educational, they're there to learn. And they're not concerned
They're also on cutting edge. So all your, you know,
and you have a team working together. So it's not one doctor making a decision. There's a group of them. And then the students are throwing their
part of the team
What
as
could
well.
This be? So
exactly.
You can tell how working together as a team, like a good sports team or a good acting group or whoever, it's all keeping that everything going and keeping it real.
Right.
Know?
So you are still reaching out. People are contributing to.
Yeah, I have a health awareness. I started a foundation, which is JBTVhealthawareness.org.
Okay.
And I did a marathon, which ran on cable channel 25. It was like every day for 12 hours.
Oh, wow.
And I had all these different people on, artists. I had Michael McGee, my surgeon, on.
Oh,
and I'll tell you a funny story about that.
Okay.
I had the Wombats in. They were they played Lollapalooza last year. And it was exciting because they. My surgeon said, I love the Wombats, and I listened to them during your surgery.
Oh, my gosh.
So we set it up so that he came and had a private little part of the show.
Okay.
And it was so exciting to see a surgeon who's very into surgery and, you know, conservative stuff, into rock and roll.
Ah, fabulous.
Yeah.
All right, so what is your website?
My website is jbtvmusic.com. And jbtvhealthawareness.org if you want to donate or keep, you know, to my massive, I got to tell you, my bills are insane. But
Right.
You know, it's part of the thing is I had no insurance, you know, it was a hard thing. But there's many people out there, and my foundation is going to help musicians and artists.
Fabulous.
And that's what I'm going to do.
In what way are they going to help?
Well, help them if they have medical expenses or things like that. And also, there's I want to promote other groups, like Immerman Angels and all these different organizations, Culinary Care, that gives you food during chemo.
Oh, okay.
There's all these nonprofit organizations that are there to help and support cancer survivors.
So it'll be like a one-stop place where you can...
Yes, you want to promote other organizations and other nonprofits. So.
Fabulous.
It's a labor of love, just like everything I do.
Right,
just like what you're doing here.
Exactly.
Yeah. Late Night Chicago.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Now, that's about all the time we've got, unfortunately.
That's it?
That's all.
It
has been such a pleasure
talking
to you.
I could talk for another 5 hours.
No, I know. We could talk to you for another 5 hours, for
sure.
Well,
you're just an incredible host. You're
Thank
at the Actors Studio.
Yes.
Yeah, I love it.
If you'd like to become a member of our show, and if you'd like the chance to come and talk with us, reach out to us at Chicago Actors Studio. We would love to hear from you and love to talk to you as well. Thank you so much for coming and talking to us. It has
Thank
been
you.
An absolute pleasure.
You're amazing.
Thank you.
Thank you
Keep
so
up the
much.
Good work here All right. Chicago.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
What an audience.
Right.
You guys.
Right. Yeah.
Here.
Hello.
And our executive director, Edward Dennis Fogell. Welcome.
Well, when you say my name, we're supposed to clap too.
Okay.
Come on, we need a round of applause, everyone.
Come on. All right. So we're going to be talking about resumes and how important they are for our actors and actresses out there in the...
I think what's more important is that they fill them out correctly to me.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay.
You know, there are resumes and there are resumes.
Right. You're not going to go to, you know, look it up online and it doesn't look like a business resume. I think that's key to know. But is there a place where you can go and find a template that you can plug into?
Well, I've seen a lot of templates on templates.
Templates.
Right. You're making me. Speak.
You say template, I say template.
Yeah, there are. I've seen templates online to show you how to do that. They're not necessarily all correct, and also it changes from time to time in the industry. Okay. How they want them filled out or something.
Right.
What's some examples of the recent changes that you can think of?
Well, they're different. Some agents will say, for instance, you put your stats on there, you know, the height, weight, and all your measurements, whatever. And some areas don't want that on there, and some areas do want it on there.
What do you mean, some areas, like theater versus film?
No, just some. Actually, I've seen a lot of casting people that says not to put that on there because they don't want them to prejudge you or something.
Oh,
you
that
know,
makes
how
sense.
You look with an actor or something.
I see.
I think it's necessary to put on if you're doing a lot of modeling or something. Mm.
Now, should your headshot be on the front of the resume, be on the back of your headshot? Is that a good idea?
The resume on the front?
I mean, sorry, the resume on the back of your headshot.
Do you work here?
Who hired you? I know, right? Oh, Lord have mercy.
Okay, your resume should go on the back, all right?
Yes, okay.
But some people print them on the back. Some people go ahead and staple them, whatever. I suggest to actually, when someone get pre-printed. In other words, if mm-hmm. if you actually pre-print it from the photo processing place, well, what happens there if you have changes or something, you can't change anything because it looks like crap. And I really don't go for staples. You know, meaning putting a staple in my headshot or something. So they have what's called a lithograph, which I think is the best way to go with a lithograph. With a lithograph, you can actually print on the back. So when you're making changes, you don't have to have all these things pre-printed and stapled. You just stick it in your printer and print it out, depending where you is, make your changes on your computer. That's the best way to go.
So you have maybe several copies of your headshot, but as the resume changes, you just use this lithograph.
Right, you just slip it in your printer and print it out.
Fabulous.
It could be you're going to an audition that was through an agent, so you'd want the agent's logo on there. Yeah. You might be doing an audition that you're getting it yourself. And then you could decide if you put your own information on their contact information or the agent's.
So I have a question, because I'm just wondering, where do you get this lithograph thing?
Well, there are a lot of companies that have lithographs. I always suggest ABC Pictures. I think they're, I don't know where they're at. They're out of state. Or
is it a national organization?
Yeah, they'll send it anyway. They have a website, and they're cheap. I mean, you can get them, and it's cheaper than photographs. Because photographs, what are they? $1, $1.25 or something like that, a photograph.
Depends on where you get them printed.
Huh?
Depends on
how many you get printed.
Yeah,
right.
Sometimes they do the bulk deals.
I don't
think
you have to print as many today as you were, years ago. You'd have 500, or 1,000 or something, because so much is done, online or something. That a lot of times you go on auditions, the casting people only want won't take your picture.
Right.
Doesn't mean you shouldn't bring it along with you.
Oh, definitely.
You definitely bring it along with you just in case.
So bring your picture and your resume with
you. Yeah, but most of the major, like Claire Simon and Marissa Ross and all of them, they usually don't take them when you do when you go on an audition.
Okay.
But there's a lot of situations where you should bring it anyway, okay?
Okay. So I think a lot of people that are just starting out as actors or actresses might want to know.
What?
Inquiring minds want to know if you don't have any experience to put on a resume, what do you put on the resume? Right?
Nothing. No, I mean, you go out and you get experience. No. I mean, if you don't have any experience,
out there auditioning.
You shouldn't be out there, in the first place. You don't have any training and whatever. Then what are you doing out there anyway? Okay, I understand. There's all different ways of getting experience through, the film, schools, Columbia, DePaul, and everything, community theater or whatever. But if you're not, when you get into a workshop, a lot of things will work out for themselves. I mean, how to get experience, where to get the jobs, and people passing on.
I have to put in a word for the Chicago Actors Studio, because I think you do a great job of helping people that are just starting out in the business to really understand kind of the stepping stones to where they want to go, instead of trying to go from point A to Z without filling in, those center letters.
What is Z?
No.
You got to fill in the center letters on the alphabet.
I actually brought my resume for you to take a look at.
Sarah, you rock.
I wanted to see if I had done things correctly, or if there were any notes you had, or if I'm making any of the common mistakes that you'd see on many resumes.
I don't think this looks too bad. You probably want to get some of the things lined up a little better.
Mm-hmm.
Let's go through here. Let's see, training. Yeah, you always want to put your last training first, and the stuff that's, each time you do some new training, you want to put it on top.
Okay.
Ear prompter is good too. That's a great skill that a lot of people.
I actually learned it here from you.
I know.
Oh, yeah.
That's
a fun
class. That's
prompter,
so much fun.
It's a hell of a skill. And you put it appropriately, so you put it in. I don't know if you can see this. We're going to put this online.
Yeah, maybe. Well, I don't know.
Maybe Jonathan can actually put it online.
Okay.
Were you highlighted in bold? Ear prompter. Let's see, the special skills.
Or some kind of template, right?
Yeah, for sure.
Did I help you with this resume?
You did.
It looks so good.
But I've changed it a bit since you had, so I wanted to make sure you double check.
Right. Now, there are some things that you know, a lot has to do with what you want to leave off your resume too.
Yeah, that's a good point.
What are some things that you'd recommend leaving off?
Yeah. There's a lot of things that you really
okay.
All right, let's go with that. One of the things you don't want to put on there is, especially when you're, say for instance, you're SAG eligible. You don't want to put SAG eligible on your resume. You know what SAG eligible is, right?
Mm-hmm. Screen Actors Guild. Yeah.
Well, just a few points away from becoming a SAG member.
Yeah. Okay. Basically, SAG eligible is that you've done a SAG production somewhere down the line. Most common SAG eligible thing is you've done a SAG production, but you did it as a non-SAG performer, and you can go ahead and join SAG. You know, anytime after you've done that. It's called the Tap Hartley Law. You work under the Tap Hartley Law.
Okay.
And what people do is that they think, well, geez, I'm going to put SAG eligible because it makes it look better. You run the risk when you put that on there of, for instance, if I was a producer and I would say, well, this is your SAG eligible, you've done a SAG production, and I would say, well, I'm only going to pay you this job is only $600 and it's going to cost you a couple of grand to join SAG. I'm not going to look inside your bank account to know if you got the $2,000 to work at $600 job.
Yeah.
So I may just decide, because you put that on there, to move on to the next...
The next person?
Yeah, to the next person, because when they do cast, they cast fast. Mm-hmm. You know, they don't want to ask a lot of questions, right? So that's one thing I would suggest, you know, not putting on a resume. I would suggest leaving community theater, you know, off your resume, because it's really, now theater to have on your resume is great, but community theater is, you know, it really is not totally respected. Most times, community theater are people that have little to no skills, or people just doing it part-time or something. It's not really easy, not really hard.
How about if you have a lead role in a community?
What's the difference?
Okay. All right.
Or something. If you find some way to hide it so it's not community theater, then I would suggest doing that.
Okay.
Same thing if you're doing your film and you're going to go out, you're going to do a lot of film students or something, like for Columbia or DePaul or something. Mm-hmm. You don't want to lie on your resume, but you want to find a way to make your resume look better.
Yeah.
Okay. So you want to put something like, maybe the guy at John Q. Smith, you put John Q., that's a student, you put John Q. Smith Productions or John Q. Smith Films or something, instead of saying it's a Columbia School, you know, project.
Right.
Things like that you want to leave off.
How about some more.
Okay, I want to make sure I covered it. Another thing you want to think about leaving off is commercials. Okay. Now, this is sort of, you know, arbitration in a way. For instance, if you are a spokesperson for maybe McDonald's or something, then maybe you want to put that on there. Okay. But most of the time what you're doing is maybe biting into a burger or something, and you're not really a spokesperson. So you go ahead and you put, well, you're proud of the fact, I mean, that you did a McDonald's commercial or whatever, and you bit into a burger and you got a few dollars for it, and you figure it's going to make you look better. The problem is that if you do that and all you bit into the burger, well, you scratch off, you know, Arby's, scratch off, you know, Wendy's, or and maybe even some grocery stores or something, or whatever jewels might scratch you off for doing fast food. You don't know how they think. If, if you did something for Coke or something, we'll scratch off all the beverages. So if you do something for beer, forget it.
So then what do you suggest writing instead of what commercials you've done? So instead of leaving that area blank?
I would put on there the commercials or industrials, and I would put on a list of conflicts, which you did. List of conflicts.
For everyone.
List of conflicts available upon request, okay?
Okay.
Because you bit into a burger, you know, at McDonald's, does not necessarily mean that's a conflict. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
But I grant you, for instance, some companies are very touchy. I mean, if you work Ford Motor Company, and they know you're driving a Toyota or something, and they're not very happy with that. I mean, you can get away with it, but if you're sitting there, you're one of the, white collar workers, and you're driving a Toyota, that's not going to work.
Right. Mm-hmm. I could see that.
So that's stuff like that. So you put a list of conflicts available on a request. They'll call your agent and they'll say, well, does this actor have any conflicts that's going to prevent them from doing our commercial? And they'll say no. You may even stretch it. I don't know if I should say this on camera. Okay, but I will tell. Even if you have done no commercials at all, putting list of conflicts on upon request, you're not lying. Okay, but you're making your resume look better, and you'd say, well, I don't have no conflicts, that's all. But it looks like what?
Looks like you may have some conflicts,
you may have done
some work.
Done some commercials, that kind of thing.
Okay.
Things like that, I would suggest.
How about if you're an extra? You know, and you're in a feature film as an extra walking down the street with your Gucci bag and this guy they assigned you to walk down the street with you.
I like how hyper specific that is.
If it's Gucci, I would say yeah. Show that Gucci. Actually, I think it's most of the time it's common knowledge, but still, when I see people's resumes that come in, we have this career counseling program here at the Chicago Actors Studio.
Yeah, it's a great program, by the way.
And I sit down and help people with their resumes, and even though it's mostly common knowledge not to put extra work, you'll still find people putting
extra work
on their resume.
It's
you want to leave it off.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
You don't want to, because what I'm, this chair, this is not a chair. This is an extra.
It's an extra.
This is an extra, because all an extra is a prop that's being used for atmosphere to develop the
reality of the shot,
that's
right?
That's all that is. And agents don't respect to having extras. Any agent will tell you not to put extra work on your resume.
All right. That's a good point.
What else?
Make a mental note of that, kids.
What's good to put on your resume?
What's good to put on
like
your resume?
Like special skills.
Prompter skills?
Yes.
Like what other special skills would you recommend that people put on their resumes?
Well, baseball, what sports, anything that might have to do with if you're good at carpentry or you are racing cars, or you have firearm experience is good, Or you beat up people like Larry over there. There's some crazy skills that you think were not skills, like playing dead.
Really?
Playing dead is actually, they look at that as being a skill, but I forgot what it is, but you got to be able to hold your breath.
For like 4 minutes or something, like a Navy SEAL?
For a period of time or something.
You
have
to be like a Navy SEAL and hold your breath.
Yeah, and I don't see it on yours here, though. Languages or something.
I only speak English.
Yeah. We could put fluent English or something.
Or if you have a very good Italian accent. Yeah.
Any special skill, miscellaneous skills you want to put, things like if you want any awards, as well, you want to put that on there, okay? On training, you don't want to put the training where it says the area of training. That has to do with industry-related training, not if you got a college degree or something.
Okay.
Your college degree or something, you want to put a miscellaneous, skills and relative experience.
Because a lot of people.
Well, here you have it. Yeah. You got a lot. You got like Texas dialect.
Yeah.
Here, you got. You can put languages
well,
dialect.
I don't
okay?
speak different languages, but I can do the Eastern Texan pretty well.
Share there you go.
Yeah, I like that.
That one's
yeah.
pretty.
Share
that
vocal
that one's
impressions.
And,
yeah. Okay, that kind of stuff. Or some, you know. There's also a little thing in special skills. I like to put something in there at the end that has to do with your personality, you know. I remember one girl, I said, I put it in there that I can't fly a jet fighter, but I certainly would love to learn or
okay.
something. You know, show something or something funny. You could show your sense of humor. Maybe if you can, what's it, flagellate on cue?
Oh, something. Lord.
I had to get something.
I know, right?
There, you know?
Or you do like pull my finger.
Well,
yeah.
Well, okay. I've been like so good here. You know?
Yeah,
you've
so
been
so
very good.
Good.
Normally, you know, I figure how long can I hold out or something, you know, to be good. If you are SAG and AFTRA, you definitely want to put it on your resume. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Yeah, you definitely, yeah. you know, should do that.
You paid for it. You got to put it on there.
You paid for it. You better put it on there. Yeah.
Right.
There's a lot of other little tidbits or something, but don't never lie.
Oh,
if
yeah.
they catch a lie on your resume, then they feel
that's your lie.
What else is a lie?
Right. Okay. Exactly.
Yeah, and everybody in the industry, it's like a cottage industry. They know who's doing what.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so you don't want to do, you know, find yourself lying in your resume.
Yeah.
But it doesn't mean you can't make your resume look better.
There's always a way to word it just right.
And word it right to make sure it looks better. You got to fix this thing here. You see
that? I see that. It's fixed.
Oh, it's
don't worry.
It's fixed.
It is definitely
it's not justified.
Are you going to show the unfixed one on camera? Somewhere?
We can put that up on the site.
You want to justify it on both margins?
Yeah. One of the other things that we'll talk about, too, is as long as we want to get as complete as we can, you know, with the resumes, is when you're listing, like you're going to put the first column would be the name of the production, the title. The middle column, basically, I guess Jonathan is showing this, would be, you know, the role, you know, the role that you're playing, and the end would be the production, basically. Now, when we come down to the role, you don't want to list on film or TV the actual character's name of the role. They're just interested in where you are, the status of that role, where you are in
hierarchy,
where you are in your career, and what they could possibly, you know, stretch to consider you for. You know, for instance, in film, if you've done the lead, supporting, or whatever it is.
Okay.
That's the same thing. Film and TV. On theater, you could list the title.
Right.
You know, the title of the role that you actually played. When you're doing training, you're going to list the course, and in the middle you're going to list what?
The instructor.
The instructor.
The instructor, correctly. And then at the end would be the school.
Is the school or the location?
The school.
Okay.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that's something I need to fix.
You can actually add the location. For instance, if you could say Ajax School, you mean in should I say bum, beep.
okay.
You can do that.
Do that. Okay.
It's like what's in but Chicago Actors Studio, you know. You think
Chicago, Illinois.
I think there's one in Michigan. Actually, we used to have a Chicago Actors Studio in La Jolla.
Really?
Yeah, absolutely.
Wow.
We were out there at one time. We had a school out there, but we just got hired because most of the time people would go ahead and sign up just to put you on, so they can put you on the resume, but they'd never show up in class.
Oh, that's crazy.
They would do that a lot out there.
Wow.
I said, well, I'm just taking, even though, you know, I'm not in it for the money. Same thing here at the Chicago Actors Studio. I'm not interested in your money. I'm interested in your learning because I love teaching. I love it even more when people learn something, and I get the biggest kick, you know, out of them, especially when I'm working with voice and diction, and I clear up their, you know, and it's there.
Your accent or something.
I just want to give them a hug or something.
Yeah.
I hug a lot.
It's good, you know. I mean, it's good to show that,
you know.
Yeah, you appreciate the effort they're making, and they appreciate you as a teacher.
I just love being part of it. you know, being part
yeah, the
of that,
about the know, whole process,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, being part of the process with a student and developing them when they start in the beginning class, they get to the advanced class. And the funny part of it is that they never feel, you know, every time, I was always giving them a challenge to do, so I'm always, mm-hmm. you know, I have never done anything right. No, you're doing everything right, you know.
Just try to push them, right?
No, always
to be better.
Them past. Instead of giving, once in a while, I'll give them something that they can easily do so they can relax with it, okay, mm-hmm. or something. But I'm always making them reach out, you know, past that. Because in this business, you're actually an entrepreneur, mm-hmm. and you have a product, and you should want your product to be the best.
Absolutely. You're the CEO of your career,
yes,
right?
Absolutely. Okay, so. What other questions, girls? I think we've
yes,
over.
I think
we've covered, over 10 minutes.
I think we're over 10 minutes. Minutes.
Yeah.
I think we went
all
over, right, then. I think we're probably
there,
at like 20.
There's a lot of things. One thing
a
I will tell you about your career is concerned, too. I think as early as you possibly can in your career, can I talk to the camera? As early as you, which one's going to get me in a close-up? Okay. Okay,
go.
As early as you can, my aunt, there we go.
Yeah.
As early as you can in your career, find a name, that you're, whatever name you're going to use, and use it. If it's going to be your name, fine. Mm-hmm. But if you ever think of changing it, I mean, you better change it as soon as you possibly can. That's a very, and you want to check with the union. I mean, you, for instance, you might be John Smith or something, and you go find the union already has a John Smith. And now you can't use it, okay? But you can use Johnny Smith.
Hmm. There
okay?
you go.
You can change it. For instance, Bill Campbell was one of our students, and you know, he's been on many, many, many different productions. And there is a Bill Campbell, so he had to change it to Billy Campbell. He couldn't use Bill Campbell, even though Bill Campbell is his birth name.
I kind of like Billy. It's a little bit
like
more friendly.
Billy? Yeah,
yeah, yeah, like a yeah.
Billy.
Billy.
Billy. I don't know. I guess you could also change it to be B-I-L-L-Y or B-I-L-L-I-E. Hmm. I think you can do that too. Yeah.
I think the I-E is a woman's mm-hmm. Derivative.
Is it really?
I think
yeah.
so.
Oh, definitely.
Billy.
You look like a Billy.
No, I'm a Bobby.
You're a Bobby? No, you're a...
Roberta is short, yeah.
No,
short.
You're the genie. What's the name again?
I dream of genie.
Yeah.
Perfect.
If you look at some of our earlier episodes, you'll see Roberta.
Yes, I'm very talented.
She knows mm-hmm. how to disappear on camera.
Right, exactly.
Can't do it now, can you, Roberta?
Probably could if you really wanted me to.
Okay. There you go.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Ed. I feel like you answered
yes.
so many questions for us.
Where's those applause?
Yes,
right?
Yes.
Thank you
Check
so much.
Check out the Chicago Actors Studio because you can really get educated here. Mm-hmm. And we just love the classes that are offered. So.
Do we want to show on screen our website or something?
Yes,
probably,
I think we should.
So
maybe,
probably
you know, yeah.
there on
Wait,
the screen.
It's down at the bottom.
And our phone number. We should show you guys too, maybe, you
yeah.
know, it's like yeah. your email addresses because you might have some producers out there that want to
oh, yes.
get in touch with you guys.
Yes. Especially yeah. if they are looking for
one of the most proud things I am is both of these
Aww.
Young ladies are my students.
Yes. I'm
Thank
proud
you.
To be.
Thank you.
I'm proud of you both. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Say goodbye.
Yes.
Yes. Thank
Hello.
You.
So much.
Thank you.
Yes, he does. He is just absolutely inspiring. It was such an honor to talk with him and learn a little bit more about his story.
Wait, I don't know about you, but
Are we visiting his studio?
Oh, absolutely. Are you kidding me? I'm going there right after
this. Make sure you check out his website. Again, it's jbtvmusic.com.
Mm-hmm.
And with that, I just want to say, you know what? We did pretty good today. What do you think? Can we get an applause?
Yeah.
This is our second season.
Right?
Second show, second season.
Exactly.
You know what? We just want to thank you. We also want to just give a shout out to Chicago Actor Studio.
Mm-hmm.
Because this is where we produce Late Night Chicago.
Yeah.
And there's some great classes here. Mm-hmm. For anybody who's interested in hearing more about the classes, you can actually go to our website or, you know, give us a call. So yeah. The number here is 773-645-0222. And then do you want to give the website? Because I always...
So, we also, if you have a project that you're working on, something coming up, we would love to hear from you. We are always looking for people to bring on, learn all about the things that are going on around Chicago. So,
absolutely.
Reach out to us
yes.
at late night. At ChicagoActorsStudio.net.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Bye,
guys.
Thank you so much.
This has been a Chicago Actors Studio production.